Chris Yeoman.
Prime Minister Chris Yeoman from the ABC. You were trained by Jesuits, so you'd be familiar with a particular examine. Mm-hmm. So, in good conscience, are you the best person to lead this government and prosecute its agenda, and have you considered resigning?
Yes and no. Yes and no, Chris. Now, let me make it absolutely crystal clear. We were elected in 2013 because the Australian people rejected chaos. That's why we were elected, because the Australian people rejected chaos. And we are not going to take them back to that chaos. We really are not going to take them back to that chaos. Let's also remember what I said time and time again at the time of the Rudd political assassination, at the time of the Gillard political assassination. Sure, party rooms or caucuses choose leaders, but once they've gone to an election, things have changed. It's the people that hire, and frankly, it's the people that should fire. So I am absolutely determined to do what we're elected to do, to clean up Labor's mess, to build a strong and prosperous economy for a safe and secure Australia, and that, I believe, is what my colleagues are equally dedicated to achieving.
Stephen Scott.
Stephen Scott from the Courier Mail, Prime Minister. You didn't mention the Queensland election in your speech, and I'm just wondering, as an interested observer, why do you think the Queensland electorate turned against the LNP so dramatically, and how will you convince your colleagues they don't face the same fate under you?
Well, I'm not a sophologist, and so I'm not going to try to analyse all the detail of the Queensland election. Obviously, it was a very difficult result, and I feel deeply for Campbell Newman and for his colleagues, because they worked hard to make a difference, and I believe they have made a difference. As I said yesterday, so I'm not, in a sense, breaking new ground here, there are lessons in Queensland. There are lessons in Queensland for all of us. And the fundamental lesson is that if you want to put in place difficult but necessary reform, you've got to explain it, you've got to justify it, and you've got to bring the people with you. Now, I accept that we have done some of that ourselves over the last 12 months. We have attempted to put in place difficult but necessary reform. I know that we've struggled in the Senate. You know that we've struggled in the Senate. And obviously there are lessons in that for us too. We do have to make a bigger effort with anything that does need to go before the Senate. Most of all, though, we have to make a bigger effort with the Australian people. We have to make a bigger effort with everyone who is involved in decision making. And one of the other things that you'll find in 2015, which is a little different from 2014, is a much more consultative and collegial cabinet process, more meetings of the full ministry, regular meetings between the cabinet and the chairman of the and chairs of the backbench policy committees. I believe it's always been, and I did serve for 9 years as a minister in the Howard government, I believe it's always been a consultative and collegial government. But it will certainly be the most consultative and the most collegial government this country has ever seen in the weeks and months and years ahead, because we are on a journey. We are all on a journey. It's the journey to build a better Australia. It's the only journey worth coming on if you are in a position such as mine. It's the journey all of you want our country to make, and we have to succeed. We just have to succeed for our country's sake.
Laura Tingle.
Laura Tingle from the Financial Review, Prime Minister. You've focused on a stronger economy in your speech and on the need for jobs. Just noticing that there are an extra 63,400 people counted as unemployed since you became elected. I'm just wondering if you could spell out for us how you're actually going to address that. And I reference your G20 economic plan, which was built heavily on investment in infrastructure, which you also mentioned in your speech. How is that affected by the changing balance of assets, asset programs in the states, and will that sort of have a material impact on the economic forecasts?
Well, Laura, look, thanks for the question, and you do give me a chance to reiterate the fact that jobs growth was three times as fast in 2014 as it was in 2013, and that's something that I think the government can be pleased about, and which all of the small businesses and big businesses out there that have been employing people much more significantly in the last year than they were previously, they can take enormous credit for. So I thank the employers of our country for what they are doing for the people of our country, employing more of them as they have in 2014. On infrastructure, Laura, I've said it many times, let me say it again, I would like to be remembered as an infrastructure Prime Minister. I'm determined to be an infrastructure Prime Minister. I accept that to achieve that, it's necessary to work with the states, and obviously we've had a change in Victoria. Who knows where things will ultimately fall in Queensland? We've had a change in Victoria. And can I say to you, the only serious thing to emerge so far from the new government in Victoria is an apparent liability to pay up to $1.2 billion not to build the East-West Link. Now, surely it is the very midsummer of madness to pay $1.2 billion not to build a road. I mean, really and truly, what does that say about the state of Victoria that they are contemplating paying $1.2 billion not to build a road? Well, you know, we are prepared to spend money. We are prepared to spend money on serious economic infrastructure that will set this country up for the future. But what Labor does is blow money constantly, and I can't think of anything more crazy than spending $1.2 billion not to build a road, given that the Victorian government's contribution, after the federal government's contribution, after road users' contribution, after the private investors' contribution, was probably only going to be $1.5 billion in the first place. So really, thank you for the question, Laura, because it's a classic example of what goes wrong when, in a fit of absent-mindedness, people elect Labor governments.
Malcolm Farr from news.com.au. Prime Minister, thanks for your address. Staying with jobs, a number of workplace matters will be reported on by the Productivity Commission later in the year. Yeah. But if I could go to your current thinking on one issue, are you aware of or have you read any credible study or research that says lowering or removing the minimum wage creates more jobs?
Well, that's not something that this government is interested in. Our position is that we want more jobs and we want better paid jobs. That's what we want. We want more jobs and we want better paid jobs. And in our system, always been the case in the past, is the case now. As far as I am concerned, it will continue to be the case. In our system, there is an umpire. The umpire, I was the minister responsible once. It was the Australian Industrial Relations Commission then. It's the Fair Work Commission now. And I support the idea of a fair umpire having the final say over these things. Now, yes, we've got to get the balance right. Yes, we want the Fair Work Commission to be conscious of boosting employment as well as of maintaining wages. But that's why we've got people in those positions. They're normally people with a lot of experience, and let's hope they continue to make good decisions for our workers' sake and our country's sake.
Catherine McGrath.
Prime Minister, Catherine McGrath from SBS Television. I guess in the hurly-burly of political life there are peaks and troughs. Uh-huh. I guess fairly this is a trough for you. In terms of economic debate, do you think that as Prime Minister you need to do more to bring the political debate forward in Australia? And do you concede in any way that the skills that brought you to government, the successful tearing down, clearly, of Labor, are not the skills needed, and there might be some rebooting there required as well?
Well, Catherine, you're asking me to speculate upon myself, and I've tried to make it my business in 21 years of public life, including 9 years as a minister and 4 years as an opposition leader, and now coming up for a year and a half as Prime Minister, I've tried to make it my business not to run a commentary on myself. There are people in this room who are paid quite well to run a commentary on politicians, and I might ask you to continue to do your job in that respect. Our country's been on a journey. Every one of us are on a journey. At every stage, we do the best we can. And I am confident that all of us in this room are more than capable of growing into the various roles that we've got.
Andrew Proben.